Hachette Audio presents Don't Quit in the Dip. Stay focused on God's promises for you. Written and read by Shaun Nepstad. I dedicate this book to my wife, Diana. Thank you for your unwavering faith and steadfast resilience, anchoring me during the times I was tempted to quit.
Foreword by John C. Maxwell. The desire to quit when the pressures of life mount is a strong and tangible force. It's a part of the human condition, and every leader from every arena will face this temptation throughout various seasons of life. But the great news is, each time our paths intersect with the desire to quit, we have a choice to grow, to change, to not quit. As I look across the landscape of our generation, sometimes I wonder if not quitting is becoming rarer and rarer. I'm not referring to career or outward success. I can see that in abundance. I'm talking about the discipline of not quitting in our characters, our marriages, our parenting, and in our generosity of love toward one another. We need more voices to speak into these areas of our inner lives and to lead this generation toward success. Don't Quit in the Dip by my friend Shaun Nepstad is a powerful and much-needed resource for all of us. One thing this book reminds us of is that we have the option to not quit, no matter how impossible our circumstances seem. But Shaun points out something even more crucial for us to understand. You and I were never designed to give up. While the desire to quit might be woven into the fabric of our human condition, so also is the resilience and the fortitude to stay in the fight until we experience victory. This book inspires and offers very practical strategies to build a lifestyle of not quitting, even in the most challenging times. It also will help you to reach out to others struggling to get out of their dips and valleys. John C. Maxwell.
Section 1. Chapter 1. Move, Countermove. You can't quit. There's a story told of a chess champion who's on vacation. Also an art connoisseur, he finds himself wandering through the hallways of a prestigious art gallery. One masterpiece stops him in his tracks and captures his full attention. It's a painting of a chess game. But this is no ordinary chess game. On one side of the board sits the devil, leaning back in his chair with a fiendish grin, confidently tapping his fingers on the table. On the other side sits a young man in utter terror, clenching his teeth, wringing his hands, sweat dripping from his brow. The painting is titled Checkmate. It appears that the young man's soul is dependent on the outcome of the game, and he's about to lose. The chess champion is so taken with this painting that he cannot look away. As his eyes scour the chessboard, his mind begins calculating. When a gallery custodian happens by, the chess champion asks, "Excuse me, sir, you wouldn't happen to have an old chessboard lying around, would you?" The custodian says, "I think I might. Let me check in our break room." He quickly returns and gives the board to the chess champion, who sets it up to match what he sees in the painting. He looks down at the board and back up at the picture repeatedly until every piece is exactly in its place. After studying the board and the painting for several moments, he steps back and crosses his arms, and a smile creeps across his face. He lifts his voice in the quiet hallways of this seemingly abandoned art gallery and says, "Young man in the painting, I sure wish you could hear me right now, because I've got some good news. The devil only thinks he has won, but I've been studying the board, and there is a move he has missed. If you could see what I see, the whole nature of this game would change. Not only would this move save you from defeat, but it would also help you win the entire game." This legend, first told in the 1800s and brought to life for me by Tony Evans, is one of my favorites. Maybe it's because I can relate to the young man in the painting, knowing I've given my best attempt at the chess game of life but still have felt cornered, checkmated. I've had unfulfilled dreams that looked like they would never come true. Slumped back in my chair and ready to give up, I have wished a chess champion would shout out the move that would turn things around. This slumped down place in life is what I call the dip. The dip. When you're in the dip, you can see where you want to be, but no matter how hard you try, it seems you can't get there. You begin to lose hope and doubt you'll ever reach it. The dip is where your dream is just out of reach and you feel stuck. We all have a dream, but there is always a dip before you get there. Sadly, most people give up in the dip. But successful people don't quit in the dip, and they're the ones who see their dream fulfilled. We've all been in a dip at one point or another. Maybe you're there now. None of us have the perfectly filtered life we present on social media, right? Every person, even the ones who seem to have everything together, has at least one area in life that isn't what they want it to be. So we sink back in the chair, staring at our life chessboard, and believe our situation is hopeless and give up. The dip can be your health. You want to get in shape, attempting every diet fad and workout routine, but nothing is working. The scale ain't moving. When it comes to losing weight and stepping on the scale, there's no such thing as too naked. You're taking out your contacts from your eyes, exhaling every ounce of air from your lungs, and stretching your arms high to try to defy gravity. Every little bit counts, or so we think. So discouragement sets in, along with the desire to eat your emotions. Maybe it's your career. You know there's more in you to express, but there seems to be an invisible ceiling keeping you from reaching your potential or landing that dream job. If only someone would just give you a chance. So you lower your expectations and trade in your high-def dream for a low-res version of reality. What about your marriage? You're giving your all, but things aren't getting better, and you're even contemplating divorce. If marriage is such a sacred relationship, why isn't God swooping in to save the day? It could be that you're single and looking for a spouse, but you just can't find Mr. or Mrs. Right, and you're tempted to settle for Mr. or Mrs. Right Now instead. The dip is also where you might stand wondering, if God has a wonderful plan for my life, why is he so slow to reveal it? Does he even see me here in this place? It feels like you have one piece of a 10,000-piece puzzle and don't know where to begin. It's where anxiety and depression have crept in over the years. You thought you could conquer them alone, but now things are getting worse. It's trying and trying to get pregnant, but all signs point to it never becoming a reality. It's where throwing in the towel seems reasonable and feels like your only option. You feel outsmarted by the enemy, checkmated. Do I have your attention? The young man in that painting is facing the biggest challenge we all face when we're in the dip. The urge to give up. He's stressed, he's filled with doubt, and he simply cannot see how any outcome will be anything other than a clear defeat. He has lost faith and is about to quit in the dip. And just like him, many of us want to give up when we can't see any hope for a positive outcome. But let me encourage you. When we are ready to quit in the dip, we have a God who's just getting started. God doesn't see as we see. He says, "My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, and my ways are far beyond anything you can imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts." Isaiah 55:8-9. Just as that chess champion saw a winning move that the young man couldn't see, God sees what we don't see in our lives. We see impossible, but he sees possibility. We see financial ruin, but he sees a path to blessing. We see the diagnosis, but he sees the way to healing. God sees the end from the beginning when all we see is our past and our present. We see a dip, but he sees another opportunity to show up and work through us and show us just how amazing he really is. Throughout this book, I'm praying we all begin to see from God's perspective, even when we feel like the young man in the painting. Backed into a corner, out of moves, with no place to go. The devil thinks he has won, but with God, it's not over. Move, counter move. From the beginning of time, we can see many instances when Satan has kicked back in his seat, full of confidence, thinking he has just thwarted God's plans. Checkmate, he thinks, until God turns the tables on him with a completely unexpected move. Let me explain. God created angels. The angel Lucifer rebelled against God, wanting to share in God's glory himself, so he convinced one-third of the angels to join him in his rebellion. Lucifer, or Satan, thought this was checkmate. But God banned Lucifer and his angelic insurgents from the wonder of heaven to roam about in spiritual desolation. Then God decided to create man. This being was created in his own image and likeness. Satan did not approve. This led to angelic conflict, and a cosmic chess game began to unfold. The devil made his move on the cosmic chessboard and convinced man to rebel against God. Checkmate for mankind, or was it? As we watch the biblical timeline of mankind unfold, what we see is a back-and-forth battle. Just when it seems Satan has cornered mankind into an impossible situation, God sees higher and responds with one more move. After the fall of man, God made his countermove. He slew an animal to provide a redemptive covering for Adam and Eve so that the possibility for salvation now entered human history. Move, countermove. So then it was Satan's turn, and he persuaded Cain to kill Abel, trying to eliminate the godly line so that God's prophecy to provide a savior for mankind, Genesis 3:15, could never come true. But God had a countermove. He allowed Eve to give birth to a son named Seth, and the Bible says that people began to again call on the name of the Lord, Genesis 4:26. Satan then responded by getting the entire known world to rebel against God through the influence of his demons. All of humanity was so corrupt that God deeply grieved his creation. However, even with the 99% of humanity in a cavernous dip, God moved and found one man who feared and believed in the one true God, Noah. He instructed him, "I want you to build a boat on dry ground during the day and print up some gospel pamphlets with a three-word sermon that says, 'It's going to rain,' and pass those out in the evening. God would then judge the world, save this one family." Move, countermove. Satan made his next move by finding a man named Nimrod, who built two civilizations, Assyria and Babylon. By bringing the two together.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.